As an infant is born, they begin the adventure of their lives. But this new world they step into is like nothing they've experienced before. So what is there to do? Learn. Learn all the time. There's no way for the developing brain to anticipate the challenges it'll face. Instead, it prioritizes the ability to take in data about the environment and analyze it, to determine attributes like purpose, meaning, and danger. This thirst for knowledge means that children are anti-fragile systems. Anti-fragile refers to a system that requires adverse stimulus to grow. Similar to how muscles will expand when lifting weights, the brain requires consistent contact with the unknown in order to completely develop.
My name is Julie Leonard, and I'm an assistant professor of psychology at Yale, and I run the Leonard Learning Lab, where we study how kids form beliefs and make decisions around actually when to try and when to give up, especially in the domain of learning. So really what motivates us to learn, and there's been a rich history in developmental psychology showing that kids are really, really good at learning. As you know, babies can learn language, they learn to walk, they can make really quick generalizations, but we've also watched kids struggle and give up. And I'm really interested in understanding that paradox, really, why kids are so capable of learning yet sometimes get frustrated and give up. The number one thing kids pay attention to when they decide themselves whether to try from watching what other people do is if that other person succeeds or fails. So if they see someone succeed, they're more likely to try hard than if someone fails. And that's completely rational, right? If someone else fails, especially a competent adult, why would kids think that they should be capable of it, right? And then after that, if they see someone succeed, then they'll pay attention to how hard they try. If they watch an adult try hard on two different tasks and succeed, and then you give them a third task that they've never seen before, that's totally different. So this one you have to press a button to make music, these ones you have to open up other things. The baby will try harder on this third totally novel task after watching an adult try hard on two previous different tasks, compared to if that adult effortlessly succeeds. So they seem to abstract that, hey, these toys or these objects are going to be difficult. But we've also shown that when parents step in and complete tasks for kids, that really causes them, the child, to be less motivated on the next task. So parents can be a positive influence and a negative influence in their actions.
Intrusive or helicopter parenting is a style where parents step into their children's lives to ensure they face no danger.
Which is the parents who tell their kids when they're doing a puzzle what to do or actually do the puzzle for them. And when those kids get older, we might call them helicopter parents when they're like, I'm gonna write your college essay for you, or I'm gonna sign you up for all the extracurriculars, or I'm gonna call the dean because I don't like something about your school. And Kyla Good at Stanford has research showing in parents of older kids that the parents who are stepping in and, you know, helping them with their college essay, they're like, this is necessary, this is helpful. So they really, it's a strong belief that that's gonna be helpful, but it's just hugely ironic because it's actually not. And so the research shows that when you step in and complete tasks for kids, it takes away their autonomy, and it makes them form beliefs that potentially their effort isn't worthwhile, or because they're not good at something, or because someone else will always do it for them.
Helicopter parenting is not a new phenomenon, but its widespread adoption is. Prior to 1979, children were given a large amount of independence from adult supervision while playing. Play is the method of learning the fundamental, non-academic life skills such as socializing, problem solving, and fear management through iterated games. These reciprocal interactions are the basis of social skills, meaning playtime is a kind of classroom for learning how to fit into society. It begins the formation of identities as independent decision makers, because children must determine fair play and justice on a small scale. However, in 1981, 6-year-old Adam Walsh was kidnapped while shopping and murdered. His father, John Walsh, in an attempt to prevent a similar atrocity from ever happening again, publicized the murder. Child abduction became a national sensation.
I'm John Walsh. A lot has happened since that day. Megan has a baby brother. There is a new federally funded National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, and our children are safer by the president's signing of the Missing Children Assistance Act of 1984. It's too late for our Adam, but it's not too late for the thousands of children who are still out there.
If you think you have information on any missing child, please call the National Hotline Center. Your call will be kept confidential.
The fear culture created by Walsh's murder fundamentally altered societal beliefs about what children were able to do. It became viewed as irresponsible in middle and upper class neighborhoods to allow children to play unsupervised, because their once ubiquitous freedom could now pose a threat to their lives. The jump from this more involved style of parenting to helicopter parenting was driven at least partially by academia. The landmark 1983 report, A Nation at Risk, by U.S. Secretary of Education Terrell H. Bell, precipitated a wave of academic reform, including lengthening the school day, strengthening the curriculum, and suggesting colleges raise admission standards to encourage greater engagement. Tightening admission standards, paired with rising demand for a college education, meant that children must be prepared from a young age to outperform their peers on standardized exams and extracurricular activities. This not only encouraged parents to sacrifice their children's social time in favor of future success, but penalized them if the freedom they gave their child meant they fell behind on the new academic standards. Altogether, these factors incentivized the widespread adoption of what would now be considered helicopter parenting. Though understandable, the fear-based underpinnings of this parenting style may be misguided. Since the 1990s, crime has steadily decreased, but this safe-at-any-price mentality now seems to reflect an overabundance of caution, and may be doing more harm than good. According to Sansetter and Kinnear in 2011, research has shown that anxious children may elicit overprotective behavior from others, and that this reinforces the child's perception of the threat and decreases their perception of controlling the danger. Overprotection may thus result in exaggerated levels of anxiety. Another study done by ASU corroborates this, suggesting that high levels of intrusive parenting weakens a child's ego resiliency, or their ability to adapt to stressors, which makes them more susceptible to negative feelings when established patterns are broken. This could contribute to anxiety or depression as the child matures. Intrusive parenting may seem like the way for parents to guarantee that their children are suitably safe and competitive in the stacked academic field, but in practice, children who are given time and space to develop resilience are more competitive later in life, with the most successful pointing to strong parental role models who offered emotional support, provided meaningful instruction, and enforced high standards.
I will say it's also extremely hard to step back and not do things for other people when you see them struggling. So I can say this in my own life. I don't have children, but I have grad students. And if they're struggling and I know I can solve the problem for them, it's so hard for me to be like, no, just let them have this moment, right? It's so much easier for me to just be like, oh, I'll help you, I'll just do it for you. But I know from my research that that's not going to help them in the long run, that they need to have those moments where they struggle and they need to experience the failure to learn from it sometimes. I also think that understanding that frustration is an okay emotion, and that sometimes, you know, I think we're kind of phobic of a lot of these negative emotions, which makes sense. Like, I don't like watching kids struggle. I understand that adults wouldn't either. But I think sometimes stepping back and be like, you know, it's maybe okay if my kid struggles in this moment. But I think that the best thing you can do is have faith in your kid's abilities, and know that they're more capable potentially than you think they are, and be curious, right? So maybe think, before I assume they can't do this, why don't I step back and see what they are capable of? Just have some of that curiosity into what the experience is for the child there, to learn from it.
Preventing a child from encountering danger stunts proper development, but children are far from invincible. In 2019, Child Protective Services reported approximately 656,000 children as victims of abuse or neglect. Trauma, or severe chronic stress, can disrupt the basic executive functioning skills that govern how different parts of the brain work together. Children who experience toxic stress have trouble concentrating, controlling impulsive behavior, and following directions.
My name is Shannon Scott, and I am a life coach and an academic tutor. I work with children who are from the ages of 6 years old all the way through college students. And my biggest grouping truly is that the high school students, 14 to 18, 19 years old, with the goal of honestly helping these kids graduate and move on to whatever their next endeavor is in life. by the time they've come to me, we are dealing with kids who are failing more than 50% of their classes. They are struggling with drug, alcohol abuse. They are young, maybe 14, 15 year olds, and they're sexually active. Every single one of these kids will sit there and tell you about how rough things are with their parents. And you know, there's two sides to every story. And I listen, I always have. A perfect example of that is, we're going to call her Jenny. And Jenny is a girl whose mom and dad were separated. Dad didn't want to be a dad anymore. Mom gets stuck with three kids. Jenny is the youngest. And mom is alcoholic and beats the kids. And so Jenny figured out very quickly that they had horse property. And if she just stayed with the horses, mom didn't care. She was outside and it was a safe place. But was she learning the right relationship between a mother and a daughter? Absolutely not. Because she was so fearful of what was going on, was she interacting with her peers? No, she isolated herself. School was, yeah, I'm going to be here. But there was always that, you know, is my mom going to pop out from somewhere? Is there going to be is somebody else going to hurt me? So her ability to focus, to stay intact with studying, to, you know, recalling the information at school was very low because her brain was focused on survival.
The Adverse Childhood Experience Questionnaire measures these traumatic experiences during adolescence. A study conducted by Erica Webster at SUNY Cortland found that children with one ACE have a 68% increased chance of having special health care needs compared to those with zero, while those with four or more ACEs have 137% increased odds. This is likely because the period of early childhood is when children rapidly develop neural connections and establish schematic frameworks to scaffold future learning. The parental relationship serves as a template for every relationship that comes after. If it's defined by physical or emotional violence or neglect, there will be a negative cascade through all social wirings because the metric for human connection has been improperly set.
So these kids they're looking for a connection with an adult who cares, who wants to take an interest in them. And the big message that I share with these kids over and over again is your parents' deficiencies. That's not yours to own. That's not yours. That's not how you have to act. And then what ends up happening is they start creating their own goals. And those goals creates their future expectations of themselves. And right, I'm right there, man, along that sideline, cheering them on, you know, the whole way. It just creates the environment that they're missing, that they're looking for.
Studies show there's a 33% decrease in the odds of special health care needs for children who report having an affectionate caregiver. A similar study reports that prevention of ACEs would cause a significant decrease in national rates of depression, stroke, cancer, and obesity. You have the ability to give your kid a good childhood. It lies somewhere between stability and freedom. The adventure of parenthood is finding it. Sometimes this means breaking a cycle of abuse. Sometimes it means learning to let go, but it is possible. So study, reflect, and always let your conscience be your guide.